Isn't it suspicious to you that a storm there could go on for 350 years without a break, and we never have storms that go on for 350 years without a break? We don't even have storms that go on for like 6 weeks without a break.
So first of all, when we have storms, it's in our atmosphere, so that's gas. We rotate once a day, and so that rotation creates what we call a Coriolis force, which moving air that moves from one latitude to another, actually has its direction deflected because of this Coriolis force, and this is why storms rotate in one direction counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere. The Coriolis force is heightened if you spin faster. So what is Jupiter? It's 1,000 times bigger than Earth. It's mostly gas, and it rotates once in about 10 hours. You want to talk about ferocious Coriolis forces? We have storms that last weeks here, hurricanes, on this little speck we call Earth that has this much atmosphere on it. Go to a planet that rotates twice as fast, is 10 times as wide, 1,000 times the volume, and is mostly gas, and you're complaining that it lasted 300 years? If you want to communicate with intelligent aliens across the gaps of space, you would use things that move at the speed of light. Radio waves have good sort of penetration properties of interstellar gas clouds and this sort of thing. So now let's find a planet and send a radio signal. That radio signal is going to have to arrive there at a time where they have not only intelligence, but technology. Suppose some other civilization was sending us radio waves and it arrived 200 years ago. Presumably, we would have counted ourselves among the ranks of intelligent creatures in the universe at that time, but we would have had no capacity to receive radio waves because radio waves weren't discovered yet. In fact, if you want to communicate with a civilization, it has to be right in the slice of time where the life on that planet achieved complexity and intelligence and technology. So perhaps there's only a narrow window over which you could actually have a radio wave conversation with aliens. So I think the only hope, really, is that we get visited by highly intelligent aliens that figured out a way to cross the gaps of space-time, thereby not being limited by the speed of light.
Isn't that the speculation of how water got here in the first place?
So the jury's still out on that. There are tags in the oceans, in the water molecule, that tell you that the water must have come from more than one source. So that's what's confusing things. We want it to be a simple thing. It all came by comets, or it all came from inside the Earth through volcanoes. Volcanoes emit lakes and oceans worth of water just out of their calderas. So the problem is, what, as we say in science, overdetermined. There's plenty of comets to have delivered all the water. There's plenty of water that could have come out of volcanoes to give us all the water. So, but in the oceans, it's clearly a mixture. And so the final word is still out on that.
Mars just got everybody's imagination. Okay. We're all going to move to Mars and live there. Either we build a biodome habitat that's basically Earth on Mars. Okay, but then you can't just wander. It's not your planet. The biodome is kind of like a global spacesuit for everybody. For me, it would be hard to call that home. Here's the thing. Mars rotates once about every 24 hours. It has polar ice caps. And on its surface, there's all this evidence that it once had running water. Meandering riverbeds, bone dry today. All right, so what you want to do is, you want to warm the planet. Get the water back on the surface, okay? And there's not much atmosphere there. It's mostly carbon dioxide, but it's only 1% the thickness of our atmosphere. So even though it's almost entirely CO2, it's not thick enough to trap the heat coming from the Martian surface that got there from the sun.
Right.
So guess how that works. Sunlight comes in, which is mostly visible light. It's absorbed by the soils, and it re-radiates in infrared. That's what gets trapped by greenhouse gases. So, everybody's wondering, let's warm the place.
All right.
Can we release some of the CO2 that's frozen on the poles? Can we get the water back out? This remains to be established.
Cool.
But I'm telling you that if we're gonna be a two-planet species, I'm thinking you gotta terraform Mars for that to happen.
There was this rock in Antarctica and meteorite discovered, ALH84001. And there was evidence in one of the nooks of that rock for possible life, traceable not to Earth, but from Mars. So the evidence was very circumstantial, but interesting nonetheless. There was chemistry there that could only happen in the presence of oxygen. They even had an electron microscope photo of what looked like a bitty bitty worm. is intriguing. That was not the lead evidence of the authors. It was just kind of interesting. I'm invited to comment on this. He had four people. I'm the astrophysicist, they had a biologist, they had a philosopher, and the picture of the worm comes up. The biologist, who was piped in by a screen, said, "That can't possibly be life." So I said, "Wow, what have I missed?" "Oh, because the smallest life on Earth is 10 times that size." His comparison with life on Earth. And then I said, "Last I checked, we're talking about a rock from Mars. Why are you using Earth to constrain your capacity to think about what exists out there?" One of the great advances in exobiology was the discovery that life on Earth is hardier than anyone had ever previously given it credit. We no longer need the room temperature pond water to have life thrive. The more we've looked in the Earth, the more we've found life doing the backstroke under extraordinarily hostile conditions, hostile to humans, that is. What that has done for us astrophysically is allow us to cast for life with a much wider net than we had previously thought we had available to us. Whereas before we would look in the habitable zone, the Goldilocks zone, not too close to a host star, your water would evaporate, not too far away, water freezes. You're looking for that liquid water zone, made liquid by sunlight. We find out all you really need is an energy source, doesn't have to be the sun. Jupiter keeps Europa warm, one of its moons. It has a liquid ocean, it's been liquid for billions of years. You want to look for life, armed with this diversity of life, the hardiness of life, even we find here on Earth, it is only broadened our search for life in the cosmos.
We have an atmosphere. It's composed primarily of nitrogen. It's 78% nitrogen, it's 20-21% oxygen. Mixed in there are particles of like pollen and dust and sand from sandstorms and pollution and smog. Now, light comes from the sun, white light. The way our brain works, and the sensors in your retina, okay? You are chemically, with the chemicals in your retina, splitting that red light into combinations of red, green, and blue.
Okay.
Okay? Broad combinations of these three. If you have more red than the others, then what you look at is gonna look more red to you.
Right.
If you have more blue than the others, it's gonna look blue. Now here's what happens. White light comes down from the sun. The particles in the atmosphere, some of them are about the same size as the wavelength of blue light. All right, now if you have a particle and light, and there's a particle that's the same size as that light, it'll reflect,
that's right.
it'll scatter, that's the proper word, okay? Bounce, scatter, and so that light doesn't make it straight through. It sends in every other direction. The light from the sun is selectively has the blue removed on its way down to Earth's surface, and the blue scatters into the air, and you have a blue sky. As the sun gets lower in the atmosphere, the path length of the light is much longer through the air, okay? So in other words, so here's your atmosphere. If you're directly above, you're going through it like this thickness. As you come down, the thickness gets more.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
Well, more atmosphere, more scattering.